Hi everyone, thanks for coming. I don't think today's guests need too much of an introduction, but by way of formality, we have senior counsel Mr. Raju Ramachandran and advocate on record of the Supreme Court, Mr. K. Parameshwar. Parmu sir is also a NALSAR grad, batch of 2007. So he's come back to NALSAR after 11 years, so it's been... So if any of you want to know what yesterday your NALSAR was like, you can have a conversation with him after the talk. So without much ado, let's start. The topic is Sabarimala, quite a relevant topic. I'd request all of you to not record anything or post anything online. This is a request from both of them. Yeah, thank you.
Hi everyone, good morning. Back in NALSAR and in the hall, 10 years back, Shyam Diwan and I debated the basic structure doctrine here. And in the 10 years that I've intervened between my last visit and now, my association with NALSAR has only grown stronger because I've had a junior Maithili from NALSAR. Parameshwar is my dear friend and a very valued professional colleague. And two of your current fifth batch, Medha and Zainab, have been my interns. So it's great to be here. Now, when I suggested, because I was given a choice of topic, when I suggested Sabarimala, it was with the hope that the judgment would have come by now and that we would be analyzing the judgment. But it hasn't come. It'll come in the next 8 or 9 days because the Chief Justice is retiring. And so the request not to record or post online is only a request for deferment. It's not a gag order on you. It's just that since, in a sense, the case is still pending, and I'm speaking to you about the arguments in the case, I think we should all wait for a few days before making this public. That's all. Now, Parameshwar and I were amicus curiae in the case. And there was another amicus curiae, a retired judge of the Delhi High Court, Mr. Ramamurthy. So it's one of those rare cases where the court appoints two senior counsel as amicus curiae. And so I want to tell you first, in a couple of minutes, on the role of an amicus curiae in a case like this. Because there's a lot of confusion about this. There are different kinds of amicus curiae. Let's understand this. In an environmental litigation, speak loudly also if you can, because in court we argue loudly. Yeah. Now, can you hear me? Yeah. In an environmental litigation, or any other kind of PIL, when the court appoints an amicus, that amicus is a kind of a filter
and places necessary material before the court to enable the court to pass an order. But the traditional amicus is the amicus in a criminal case where someone who doesn't have a defense lawyer is assigned a lawyer by the court. So when I was amicus in the Kasab case, people who were already a little confused on what amicus meant, they asked me in surprise, "You mean to say you're going to defend Ajmal Kasab?" I said, "Yes, in a criminal case, an amicus curiae is a defender." Now the third kind of amicus is the kind of amicus which the court wanted in a case like this, where there's a complex constitutional issue and the court wants a senior counsel to present his or her point of view. And the court took the precaution of appointing two amicus with the idea of inviting two different points of view from the amicus themselves. I need to clarify this only because a lawyer in the case asked me, "As an amicus, are you supposed to take a stand?" And my reply was, "Of course. My job is not just to tell the court, these are the cases for, these are the cases against. You please decide." I think in that area, the court would have got much better assistance from their law clerks than from an elderly lawyer like me. So let's be clear on the role of an amicus in a case like this. And the stand which I took was that the bar on the entry of women between the ages of 10 and 50 was unconstitutional. Why was it 10 and 50? I think many of you would have followed the case, but it bears repetition. 10 to 50 was the broad perception of the reproductive age of a woman, and the basis of the belief because of which women of that age group were kept out was the deity in this temple of Ayyappa, not in all Ayyappa temples, but in Sabarimala, the deity is a celibate, and a celibate god should not set his eyes on a fertile woman. That is the belief. And it is not for us, and it is not for any court to question belief. That is the red line which the courts have always drawn. We are not going to cross the Lakshman Rekha of questioning a belief. But in our constitutional scheme, would that belief, which is the belief held by the larger group, they claim themselves to be a religious denomination, that's a different aspect altogether. Would the belief of the plurality, should that come in the way of an individual woman believer exercising her right to worship? Now, what are the fundamental rights involved in a case like this? There is, of course, the fundamental right under Article 25(1), where all persons are equally entitled to worship. As against that is the fundamental right of the religious denomination to manage its own affairs in matters of religion. But then there are other fundamental rights involved. Article 21, which includes dignity and now very clearly privacy as well. Article 15, apart from 14, non-discrimination on the ground of sex. And Article 17 as well. And this is an area we have invited the court to speak on, but it remains to be seen whether the court will touch Article 17 at all. And please remember also two other overarching concepts. One, from the preamble itself, liberty of thought, belief and worship. Think of the idea of fraternity, which also postulates brotherhood and equality. And also think of the concept of constitutional morality. Now, constitutional morality is a buzzword which has gained currency recently, both in the context of the Delhi government case, Union Territory of Delhi versus the central government, and also in the 377 judgment. But here, the court is called upon to apply constitutional morality specifically with reference to the meaning of morality in Articles 25 and 26. So not a broad, overarching, brooding morality, but the word morality as occurring in Articles 25 and 26, but which is bound to have its bearing on the meaning of morality in Articles 19.2 and 19.4 as well. Because the freedoms under Article 19 as well can be restricted, among other grounds, on morality as well. So the implications of the court ruling on morality here in the context of 25 and 26 would definitely have a bearing on its interpretation of morality under Articles 19.2 and 19.4 as well. But let's look at 25.1 and 2. Subject to public order, morality and health, and to the other provisions of this part, all persons are equally entitled to freedom of conscience and the right freely to profess, practice, and propagate religion. Let's pause here, because one of the major arguments on those who favor, who have spoken in favor of entry of women, is that this right is to be found under Article 25.1 itself. Because if all persons are equally entitled to freedom of conscience and the right to freely profess and practice and propagate religion. It means a woman believer between the ages of 10 to 50 is as equally entitled as her male counterpart to worship at the altar of the deity in whom she has faith. So equally under 25.1 postulates not just interfaith but intra-faith parity. If this is subject only to public order, morality and health, what is that morality? And it is our argument that it can only be constitutional morality, which cannot tolerate, which cannot accept a discrimination on the ground of sex or on the ground of a characteristic or a biological feature which is solely attributable to sex. It's important to keep this in mind because one of the arguments of those who opposed entry was this is not a discrimination on the ground of sex because women below 10 and above 50 are entitled to go into the temple. But if you keep out a substantial section of women based on a physiological feature which is peculiar to their gender, it is nothing but discrimination on the ground of sex. Then Article 25.2, nothing in this article shall affect the operation of any existing law or prevent the state from making any law. B, providing for social welfare and reform or the throwing open of Hindu religious institutions of a public character to all classes and sections of Hindus. A major argument has been classes and sections doesn't mean only castes, as was sought to be argued. Women are a class or a section which would get the benefit of a temple entry law which is already in existence in the state of Kerala. Now come to 26. Subject to public order, morality and health, every religious denomination or any section thereof shall have the right B, to manage its own affairs in matters of religion. So this is again subject to morality. Therefore, assuming that this is a denomination, if it is managing its own affairs in matters of religion by excluding a section, namely women in a particular age group, is it or is it not falling foul of constitutional morality? Then, when it comes, I won't speak separately on Article 15 because it is implicit in what I have already said, that it's discrimination on the ground of sex. Now, in 21, there is a violation of dignity if a woman is told that she can't enter a temple because she is of that particular age group and she is a menstruating woman. And surely there is a violation of privacy also, because in a situation like this, there is forced disclosure. A woman for menstrual status, because if a woman is joining her family on a pilgrimage, then she's obviously disclosing that she is not a menstruating woman. And if she is compelled to stay back at home, then she's involuntarily disclosing that she is a menstruating woman. Surely, if the right to privacy so solemnly given to us by Puttaswamy is to mean anything, it should mean something in this intensely personal and private context. Now, let's come to Article 17, untouchability. And this argument on untouchability is something challenging. It remains to be seen whether the court will answer the argument or not. Because all of you, as students of constitutional law, know that there is a rule of prudence and also convenience in constitutional law that the court would not decide matters which it does not find necessary to decide for the purpose of a case. And therefore, if the woman's right to enter the temple can be upheld on Article 25 itself invoking constitutional morality, invoking discrimination on the ground of sex under 15, or dignity and privacy under 21, then it would be easy to sidestep this argument. But it is an important argument which needs to be answered. Now let's read Article 17, because all of us have grown up thinking that 17 was meant to prevent untouchability on the ground of caste. Now 17 says, untouchability, I don't know how many of you have noticed the many times that you might have seen Article 17, that untouchability is in inverted commas. Untouchability is abolished and its practice in any form is forbidden. The enforcement of any disability arising out of untouchability shall be an offense punishable in accordance with law. And there is a law also, the Protection of Civil Rights Act, which again refers to untouchability in inverted commas and doesn't define untouchability. So the Constitution doesn't define untouchability, nor does the Protection of Civil Rights Act. Now, does the use of inverted commas make all the difference? Because this was an argument which I had to meet. with the able assistance of your former alumnus. Now, the argument against my argument that this amounts to untouchability, that barring a woman from entering a temple because she belonged to that particular age group was a form of untouchability, the argument against was, no, this was meant only to prohibit untouchability on the ground of caste. And the entire basis of that argument was the Constituent Assembly debates used untouchability in inverted commas. That's how it was incorporated in the article. The debates showed that we all understand what untouchability means. One of the speakers in the debates even said, if we don't define it, it would mean tomorrow it could extend to women. This was also menstruating women. Yes, in fact, it was mentioned because in Hindu society and in other societies as well, there is a different concept also when there's a bereavement, when there's a childbirth. People traditionally wouldn't go to a temple for a 40-day period, for an 11-day period, etc. So, one of the arguments was that if you don't define untouchability, then this will apply to all those as well. But nevertheless, they chose to put it in inverted commas, and that's how the Act also put untouchability. But then the question is, does the doctrine of original intent, and let's assume that this was the original intent, does the doctrine of original intent inhibit the court? Should it inhibit the court today, 68 years after the Constitution, from giving a progressive and creative interpretation to Article 17? Please remember, all of us invoke Article 21 so easily today in myriad situations. What was the original intent of Article 21? Has that come in the way of the Supreme Court creatively interpreting 21? And should the Supreme Court not be consistent with its own approach in the matter of dignity to carry it forward and now creatively and purposively interpret Article 17 itself? So now we all wait with bated breath for the Supreme Court judgment. In a sense, I'm relieved that the judgment didn't come yesterday or day before when we made preparations for coming here, because if the judgments had come, all of you now know how long Supreme Court judgments are. All of you now know that every judge wants to say his or her piece. Imagine the strain on our juniors there and our interns in digesting those judgments for us. We wouldn't have been able to sleep in your beautiful guest house if the judgment had come. So you'll analyze the judgment separately. So as I said, we wait with bated breath for the judgment. And I wait with bated breath now for what Parameshwar has to say, because Parameshwar is a product of this fine institution. He's a fine advocate. I am sure he is not going to repeat what I say, re-emphasize what I say. I have great faith in his originality. So let's hear him.
Let me begin by saying that it's such a wonderful pleasure to be back on campus. I was just telling them, I've been talking non-stop on the way from city to campus. A lot of memories that come back. But Raju sir said that we'll go to NALSAR for this talk on Sabarimala and fundamental rights, I suggested that you're going to a supposedly liberal bastion. So if you have to pep up things, we can't be just saying that what we argued in court. So while he has given you what our perspective was in court, I will attempt to give arguments on the other side. Although I've assisted him on the side saying that women must be allowed entry, I am trying to put forth, which I hope are some rational, plausible arguments, and I think they need serious consideration. Because what happens to us is that in a case like this, it's very easy to be dismissive about the concerns of the other side. These are very serious constitutional implications if the court overlooks some of the points that I think that the respondents raised. So although some of these arguments were raised in fact in court, I am trying to give my own spin to those arguments and see whether they meet your constitutional conscience. And I begin very technically. First is the issue of locus. And the judgment comes out. You would probably would have already seen the reports that the petitioner in the case is a lawyers organization, Indian Young Lawyers Association. What business does a lawyers association have in trying to reform a temple or a religion? First question. Who are the members of the association? We don't know. How many of them are Hindus? Court has not been told. Among the Hindus, how many of them, if there are Hindus, how many of them actually believe in this deity? Court is not told. There are number of interveners, not one, and take it from me, not one has averred in their affidavit that they are actually believers of Lord Ayyappa. So this court today is being called upon to allow entry of women on the basis of petitioners and interveners who either have not said they are devotees of the Lord or that even they belong to the larger Hindu religion, that they affirm faith in the larger Hindu religion. They have not said that. Now it can be very easily dismissed as a technical objection, because I also started by saying it's a technical objection, very easily dismissed as a technical objection. But there is something more to it. And I am hoping to make this argument by the use of illustrations. Look at what's happening. There is a devotee who comes, a person who comes to court and says, I need to get into that temple. The prerequisite for that is that the devotee must say that I am a devotee of that God. Why is it essential that the person who comes to court says that he or she is a devotee of that particular deity? You're not claiming a right to housing, shelter, health, education, food, because those are a given if you are a person, citizen, depending upon the right. You're not claiming a right to speech. What you're claiming is a very, very particular right today. And that particular right is that there is a deity, that deity is in Sabarimala, and I need to visit the deity because I'm a devotee. If you don't even ever that state that you are a devotee of that particular deity, what right are you claiming? Because this is not a right. The right to worship is available to all, the right to worship this particular deity in that particular form, in that temple, can only be available to a believer. It can't be available to all. The most fundamental aspect was that, according to me. If that is so, the natural question is, let's assume we are going to decide the case on behalf of devotees. Those devotees who are not present before the court, but who are represented by these public interest litigants. Then comes the second question. Is there any proof, any writing, any reform movement, any protest, any strife, anywhere in the last 50, 60 years, which is of evidence is there? At least they must show something, demonstrate that women have been concerned about entering this temple. None. Not placed before the court. When you say that you are invoking the public interest jurisdiction of the court, there must be some evidence, according to me, that there is actually a class of women who have been over the years fighting for entry, have because of their inabilities not come to court on their own, but are being represented by public interest litigation. After all, that is the origins of a public interest litigation, that litigation that people are otherwise unable to come to court, either as individual or as a collective, are unable to, are given the chance to plead their case through a public interest litigant or a public interest litigation. This has also not happened. There is one crucial aspect, then, according to me, the most crucial aspect. Suppose you can ask me that, okay, suppose they had averred that they are devotees, then would your objection be satisfied? The answer is no again. That's for this reason. When a devotee comes, she says she is a devotee of this deity. She cannot claim, according to me, she is a devotee of certain attributes of that deity and not of certain other attributes. This is very important. The deity in Sabarimala is an Aishtika Brahmachari, celibate. And his celibacy, it is believed, is such a fierceful celibacy that even the sight of women in during their reproductive age violates his oath of celibacy. Now that's supposed to be the form of that deity in that temple. It was argued very beautifully by Mr. Parasaram that every deity has a physical and philosophical form. So you have a Ganesha who has a certain form. So if you go to a temple, I take you to a temple and I say, this is a temple of Lord Shiva, but the deity has a conch and discus in his hands. Obviously you are going to disbelieve me because there are certain physical forms attributed to Lord Shiva. Similarly, there are certain philosophical forms attributed to deities. In common. The best example I can give of the avatars of Vishnu. You can't go to a Narasimha temple and say, no, this Vishnu has to, he's an avatar of Vishnu, but he can't have lion-like features. Because a Narasimha temple, there will be a deity in that physical form. There will be a deity, so a deity, apart from having physical forms, also has philosophical forms. And this is a very important thing. And what happened, according to me, is that the argument, this argument got colored when they said there are numerous Ayyappa temples where women can go. Why should women insist on going to this Ayyappa temple alone? There is no other Ayyappa temple in this country where entry of women is prohibited. There are, according to the respondents, more than 1,000 Ayyappa temples in this country. So the court thought as if, or rather, the impression that was created is that why do you insist on only going to this temple? It's not a question of insistence on going to one temple. The question is, Ayyappa in different temples may have different forms. In this form, this deity is a celibate deity. You might say, we are not concerned. if Lord Ayyappa is of that form, because for the arguments that Sir just made now, women must have entry. If that is true, the most troubling part of the argument is then said, is visible then. So the court is going to say, in other words, that a deity cannot have certain attributes. Please pause for a moment and think what sort of power the court is exercising. The court is going to first time say, if it says this, even if it doesn't use these words about the attributes of a deity, if it says women are permitted entry, despite the argument being made that Lord Ayyappa there is a Naishtika Brahmachari, the court is saying the constitution gives us the power to say that the God you believe in can or cannot have certain characteristics. And that's the most significant part of this case. The significant part of the case for everyone else could be entry, could be issue of discrimination. But the most fundamental part, and according to me, an extremely worrying part, and I've been articulating this to Raju sir since the day one I assisted him, saying that if the court were to accept our arguments, it is going to first time to put it in legal language, judicially review the attributes or characteristics of a God. It might not be a big thing, and I'm very consciously using these words, this might not be a big thing for a religion which has a few crore gods, 33 crore gods as Hinduism believes in. Imagine the power of the court if a similar argument is based placed in relation to a religion which has only one God. Very frightening. Extremely frightening. What can be the consequence? There are religions which have only one God in this country, and then what will the court do? This question, for whatever constraints, because in the court there are constraints to be politically correct, not to make unwarranted observations, but this is a question that was never raised in the present form in which I am raising today, that what happens, because the right to religion is a right that all religions enjoy. What you call the minority rights in the constitution are only Article 30, which is not in relation to religious rights, which is in relation to educational institutions, etc. The origin of religious right, the right to religion and worship, etc., for all religions is in 25. If it can be done to religion A, it can be done to religion B, it can be done to religion C. So this is a very, very important aspect of the case. So one is locus, and I can say that the other term comes within the area of justiciability. Justiciability, as is traditionally understood, is whether a matter is capable of being adjudicated to the process of a judicial system. So we say there are historically lot of things were thought to be non-justiciable, but over the years judicial power has increased to such an extent that most things under the sun today are justiciable. Economic policies are justiciable, even though they deal with allocation of resources that the courts simply cannot handle, because economic policies deal with distribution of resources. Different considerations come into play. For example, for a long time it would have the original view, or not the conservative view, of the power of judicial review. It would be impermissible to decide whether there should be liquor vending on the side of highways, if there should be, how much distance should those shops be. All matters of policy, so many multifarious aspects involved that a court can't do if it hears two parties to a conclusion. So according to me, this goes to the root of justiciability. Why does it go to the root of justiciability? Because it is a matter of belief. It is not a matter of rationality. I venture to say that the Constitution operates in one dimension and the question of belief operates in another. Now, there is a negotiation that must happen. There is no doubt about it because all of us have to live within this constitutional scheme. But if you juxtapose each of them, the results can be quite frightening because you can't be asked to rationally prove your belief. You can't be asked to show evidence of the existence of a supreme power or that you believe or not believe in the existence of a supreme power. And if you adopt your rational standards to matters of belief, and this is going to be the most testing case in the recent times, that you are going to say that these dimensions must just collapse and there can only be a rational method of seeing whether your belief is something that you can hold close to your heart, whether you have the right. Now this might seem as a argument et terrorem, as they say that thing. I'm going to tell you the possibilities of what will happen in case you hold this. This can't be the way in which a court has to be convinced of a constitutional argument. So there are three arguments I'm going to place apart from this in favor of the opening, restricting the entry of women. The first is the most complex. And as he said, this term constitutional morality is a very recent usage in Indian constitutional jurisprudence, especially the Supreme Court. If I'm not mistaken, it starts with NALSAR, the Delhi High Court, invoking constitutional morality as quoted by Ambedkar, then used in Manoj Narula by the present Chief Justice in the context of criminalization of politics, then used in the NALSAR case, then on the rights of transgenders, then used in the Delhi government NCT dispute, then used now recently in Navtej Singh Johar. All of them attribute origin of the term, so far as India is concerned, is Ambedkar's speech in the Constituent Assembly, Constitutional Morality. He uses it four times in the Constituent Assembly debates. Out of that, three times, we don't know in what context, in the sense, it's more or less irrelevant. The only time he chooses to speak clearly on the concept of constitutional morality, he does so in the context of institutions, as how even the institutions that get formed under constitution can't act in an arbitrary manner, but have to be informed by a constitutional morality where they act as if faith of the people, the power actually vests in the people, but has been given to you to be exercised in their favor. In the sense, for them, for their benefit, not in their favor, for their benefit. So, he talked about constitutional morality not in terms of substantive morality, but something like conventions where the law is not clear, etc. That's why it was invoked in Manoj Narula, according to me, rightly invoked in the Delhi government also, because if there are silences about how government should work, then the concept of constitutional morality could be invoked to say that there should be certain conventions, protocols, etc. But the danger lies, and I tell you why Ambedkar said, because immediately after this he says there are two things that must inform me, institutions in this country and how the government is run. All this comes while he is discussing that why should a constitution like ours have such detailed procedures of how the government institution should work, because most other constitutions at that time didn't have such detailed provisions in the constitution itself as to how ministers ought to be formed, how the government ought to be formed. ministers, how does the assembly work, how does the parliament work, what will be the system of giving grants, devolution of grants from the state to center. It is in this context that he invoked constitutional morality. So he says two things. Why I am saying these two things he says, because to understand in what sense he used constitutional morality. First thing he says is, if we need this constitution to work, and he was opposed to Gandhi's ideology, and that's why he said this very clearly in the Constituent Assembly, you must abandon all methods of revolution regardless of the level of violence. According to him, civil disobedience has no place in a constitutional system. And two, again, because of the Gandhi phenomenon, he said there can't be too much bhakti in one man or his abilities. So it is in this context that constitutional morality was articulated in the Constituent Assembly debates, not in the term that the court now seeks to use it in the 377 judgment. Why is it problematic? Why do I say that using of this term in a substantive sense problematic? According to me, it will render all sort of diversity at some point of time or the other extremely difficult to tolerate if this term is given this meaning. Because you will have straitjacket definitions of this constitutional morality, because you're going to ask that if 14 is constitutional morality, there can't be discrimination, there can't be any sort of play in the joints. We're going to have a unistructured system. Why do I say that? Sir indicated that the term morality finds place in four places in the Constitution. Twice in Article 19, in the restrictions part, 1 in 25, 1 in 26. Suppose morality is constitutional morality, and in that flow, it will mean you have to be liberal. There must be freedom of speech. You will have to have a more liberal culture of speech. You will have to have an absolutely non-discriminatory stand. I'm not justifying discrimination. It talks about absolute equality. The constitutional morality will then border absolute equality. If that is the meaning you ascribe to morality, what will happen if there is a writing that hurts a particular religious sentiment? You all know that under Article 295A, hurting religious sentiments is made an offense. Now, though the Supreme Court chose to defend it or constitutionalize that provision, saying that on the basis of public order, it's a well-known critique that all religious hurtful speech does not affect public order. You understand? Every speech that tends to hurt religious sentiments may or may not hurt public order. Then you will have to only resort to the term morality to say, no, you can't offend somebody else's moral sentiments. Why do I say this? Because if you use the term constitutional morality, you think that constitution is the fountainhead of morality, whereas it is not so. Morality is very cultural. In India particularly, because if it is cultural, it has very religious undertones. So a person's morality is hedged because of his cultural upbringing, his religious background, socio-economic conditions, etc. You give this power to define constitutional morality to the judges, and I fear that it will be one standard. A standard which may be tolerant of certain things, a standard which may not be tolerant of certain other things. Let me give you some examples. If constitutional morality is a touchstone on which we evaluate religious practices, and some of these examples were actually given, how will you support self-flagellation? It would have happened in the whole city yesterday. How do you support self-flagellation during Muharram? How do you defend it? Because then obviously it is causing bodily hurt. Piercing of rods or you a live example. I don't know whether the judgment is reserved on that also. Female genital mutilation, where they say, okay, female genital mutilation is bad, equally male circumcision also has to be bad, because that again violates your sense of constitutional morality. Whose sense of constitutional morality? The court's sense of constitutional morality. I understand that this is the traditional argument against excessive judicial review also, but this is even more powers in the hands of the court, because the court will now say what is moral, what is not, what is immoral in terms of the constitution. Santara, practice of Santara in Jainism. People who definitely think it's violative of constitutional morality. So question is then, and we thought when these examples were given, there was a judge who responded immediately, all these are examples that were given of people voluntarily doing this, whereas women are being forcefully kept out. But Santara is practiced by children among Jains. My junior gave me the example of when I told him that there are practices which could border on constitutional immorality, like in Hindu, many forms of ascetics are given sannyasa from when they are brahmacharis. So they are yet to be 18 and they are initiated into sannyasa. So my junior tells me that's forced labor. So I'm saying, please think about it, the idea that the court gets to define what should be a pervading constitutional morality can be frightening. I'm not here to say that these practices are acceptable, not acceptable, could be, would not be, because I'm saying it's all very deeply cultural, deeply religious. And the other thing which I made, that when a devotee comes, she says, okay, I am a devotee of Ayyappa, but not of this attribute. Because definitely she's questioning this attribute when she wants entry. So that's why I say it's not a mere technicality. And I want to take that point to the next level. Why? You see the problem in this. If you are saying equally entitled to, and the deity has certain attributes, then you say, okay, I am entitled to worship the deity, but the deity ought not have these attributes because it is not in consonance with my idea of what a deity should be or what the constitution's rational idea of what a deity should be. If that argument is accepted, how will you justify the fact that she is a devotee of the deity? Because if she is a devotee of the deity, she is the devotee of the deity as a whole. It can't be she is a devotee of the deity in parts. And that's where I think Article 25 requires a nuanced interpretation. And I'm again reading this, and I think one practice all of us must pick up is to keep reading that provision again and again. 25 is subject to public order, morality and health, and to the other provisions of this part. All persons are equally entitled to freedom of conscience. That's one part, equally entitled to freedom of conscience. And the second part is right freely to profess, practice and propagate religion. I say that this article must be read in two parts. One, the right to pursue your conscience in the private sphere, and the other, to take part in organized religion. Why is that important? You can't walk into a religion and say, no, the religion must reform for me. There is a difference when you say, I have the right to think that such and such entity is a god, and how I practice worshipping that deity in my house is going to be certainly different from the practice of organized religion. Because organized religion is not just about you. It is about how that religion has understood that deity and its practices for centuries or for years. Let me give you an example. And the interpretation of the Supreme Court consistently has resulted in this kind of incongruency. Today, under the law, constitutional of this country, the right to business and to run a trade is receives far greater protection than the right to run a temple. The interference that is permissible in a temple will not withstand scrutiny for even a second if it is in the right to practice a profession. So I can't be heard. I'm just winding up. I can't be heard to say that I want to, and I'm going to give you take the example of a public sector undertaking, an oil PSU, and say I am not at a shareholder, but I have a right to become a shareholder if I give money. But before that, I want you to amend your articles of association so that you don't do business outside India. Okay? Will this stand scrutiny in a court? Please mark this. It's a public sector undertaking, doing public service. It's an oil PSU. It's a governmental function. Can't get better. They say it's a public temple. I need entry. But I am saying, I have the money. I'm willing to deposit it in court. I want to be a member, shareholder. But before I become a shareholder, you must direct them to amend their articles of association and say that they can't do business outside the country. So I'm saying what protection that business houses receive in this country, perhaps religions will not have in case these arguments are accepted. These are just a few pointers. Thank you.
After hearing Parameshwar, you understand what NALSAR has taught him, that there are two sides to every debate. And so Parameshwar, who's really the author of my written submissions to the court, has powerfully and rationally put forth the other point of view. And therefore, I think all of you who aim to be professional lawyers, some of you would have the idea of being activist lawyers. Some of you who want to be corporate lawyers won't be facing any of these dilemmas. But if you wish to be professional litigators, whether constitutional or otherwise, please understand that there are two sides to every controversy, to every case, and that will help you in developing your courtroom etiquette as well, because there's a common tendency even among lawyers who practice for donkey's years like me. When the other side is arguing, what nonsense, what crap? No. There are no blacks and whites. And so, while I hope for the effort which both of us have put in and which the petitioners have put in, while I hope and pray that the court rules in favor of entry of women, please understand that this is one of the most complex and difficult cases which the Supreme Court has been called upon to decide. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was a really insightful talk, and I think the format was quite interesting because we got to hear both sides. We came with the assumption that we'd only be hearing the petitioner side. I'd like to open the floor for questions now. So if you couldn't just raise your hands, I'll pass the mic.
Hi, sir. Thank you both very much for allowing us to hear both sides of the argument again. That was very insightful. My question is a little bit of a response to the arguments of the petitioners as you put forth. The respondents, sorry, for denying entry. So, and this is a problem that I personally have with respect to the whole idea of constitutions being in one dimension and religious beliefs being in the other. Because I see this as being on the fact that religion needs to be given that higher sort of protection for whatever reason, because say religion is such an intrinsic part of life, etc., etc. However, I really don't see the problem personally in saying that we saying, because religion is also an institution, at least sociologically speaking, and religious institutions such as the Sabarimala Temple Trust are also institutions. Therefore, I think an argument could possibly be made about having them come under the form of constitutional morality that, say, Ambedkar was speaking about as well. And in such a scenario, I don't see why religions should not be subservient to the constitution of a country, particularly when we say that and religions are premised upon this public-private divide about private worship with a deity versus public practice. And in this case, if the burden is being placed upon me as an interested party to go to the temple to explain why I should be allowed to do so, I think it's also worth looking at the fact that it's a religious group or the of the temple trust which has been making that argument for me for centuries and keeping me out. And as a result, I don't see why that should be allowed to be separate of the constitution at all.
You answer it and then I'll answer it also.
When I say that they are in two different dimensions, I don't mean that religion is outside the constitutional purview. When I say that they are in two different dimensions is because I say that it's very difficult to rationalize through a judicial process a religious belief, because it is a belief, because it is your conscience. It is not a fact as we know. I don't say belief is not a fact. It is not fact as we know. It is not fact as we are taught a fact is in a court of law. So it is in that sense that I said that they work in two different dimensions. Why is it important to acknowledge that? Because if you don't acknowledge that, that's what I am saying, you fall into what I could say is a liberal trap. You fall into a liberal trap where only rational beliefs are permissible. You start with this, then you fall into the trap that only rational beliefs are permissible. I am saying this is not the best case to make my case. No, because it's a case of women. The argument is one of menstrual taboo. You know, I understand all those problems are there. But as you know, the law, big cases make bad law. Big cases make bad law. You started in this. You started with this argument that menstrual women taboo, permit entry. You don't know what the next case is going to be. It's in that context I said that. And I'm even that public-private divide, when I said that in the context of somebody who wants to approach organized religion. And there have been established cases on this. I'm not saying it just out of the top of my head. Just see, the Dawoodi Bohra case was one of that. I don't know, I'm sure some of you at least would have read the Dawoodi Bohra case. Dawoodi Bohra case included, was a case where the state passed, the Bombay state passed an act saying that excommunication will be unlawful henceforth. So the Dai, who's a spiritual head of the Bohra community, hitherto enjoyed the power to excommunicate and discipline his followers or followers of the Dawoodi Bohra religion. And the Supreme Court said no, that is an essential part of his powers within the religion that he must, because if you are going to practice an organized religion, discipline is an essential part because you have to keep the flock together. If you are inside it, you can't be allowed to question it. And in that opinion, please note there is a separate opinion by Justice Rajagopal Iyengar, who says reform can't be used to rationalize a religion out of existence. 25(2)(b) when gives the state the power to reform, reform can't be used. So it is in that context I said when you go practice an organized religion, the right is, according to me, a little more, should be stated in a little more nuanced fashion than the right to choose any god you want to believe in, you want, you can worship at home. But when you go and approach this approach a god who's already there in an organized religion, the right is, according to me, tempered by what the beliefs of the religion, core beliefs of the religion are. That's what I said.
But then, to support what you are saying, I have a problem with this interfering with the characteristics of a deity or questioning the characteristic of a deity. Now, the celibate example is one example. Let's take a totally different example, because as Parameshwar said, there are 33 crore deities in this religion. Now let's suppose that there is one particular deity who assumes the avatar not of a celibate but of an orthodox Nambudri Brahmin, and that deity cannot set eyes on a Dalit. That is the roop of that deity. That is the roop, avatar of that deity. Would the same considerations then apply? Should the constitution then come in or not? So celibate was a completely different example, but you can have examples like this. Or there could be, again, a blood-drinking deity. Yes, so there again, we don't have an easy answer.
So my question is with respect to what the level of intervention must be of the court with respect to cases such as these. And there has been an essential practices doctrine that the court has been using for many cases. What is your take on that doctrine? Because even going into the facts of what is an essential practice requires going into what the beliefs of that religion are, and what the, say, the trust thinks the beliefs are, what the devotees think the beliefs are, and what the court thinks those beliefs are. So what is your take on that sort of aspect of these cases?
Are you asking Parameshwar, asking me, or shall both of us answer? Both of us have something to say on this. No, that's a very good question, because this has troubled Supreme Court judges. There is a fairly recent judgment of 2016, I think, Adi Shaiva, where that's a two-judge bench decision, where Justice Ranjan Gogoi, the next Chief Justice, says even in the absence of an ecclesiastical jurisdiction conferred on our courts, as part of our difficult job, we have to determine what are essential religious practices. Because on the one hand, the court is sworn to the constitution, and being sworn to the constitution, you are bound to uphold the rights of religious minorities, of religions, and so protect essential religious practice. And essential comes in order to avoid unnecessary accretions, which then get the protection of religion. But then in the course of this hearing, Justice Chandrachud in his oral observations voiced a different concern. He said, we who are not equipped, why are we constantly being asked to see what is essential, what is not? We can't be doing that. We must administer the Constitution, uphold what the Constitution permits, and not permit what the Constitution does not permit. But then again, what is the Constitution? The Constitution is what the judges say it is. Would you like to add to this?
Perception that the essential practices. Practices doctrine.
Hello. The essential practices doctrine is only belongs, has its roots only in one part of Article 25, which says the state can regulate economic financial matters, it can also do social reform. So the history of the doctrine, the origin of the doctrine are in those cases where the state said, and all of them are Endowment Act cases, where temples were being managed under different state enactments. Bulk of them came from South India, and they have a long history. So there the state had always managed the finances of the temple. It had managed the appointment of trustees, in some cases the appointment of archakas, priests to the temple. So in that context, the origin of the doctrine took place. The court was asked whether this is a matter of religion, or this is a financial economic matter that is only ancillary to religion. In that context, the Supreme Court envisaged an essential practices doctrine, saying if it is essentially religious, then the court should not, the state must not allowed to, must not be allowed to interfere with those factors. So it is in that context the essential religious practices doctrine came. It's not as if in every case involving 25 the court is asked, should be asked the question whether it is essentially religious or not. The flip side, as sir was saying, the flip side of the argument that and all three views came to discussion during this case. One extreme view is, doesn't matter what the religion says, the Constitution trumps. That's one extreme. The middle path is, we will try and filter to the constitutional lens what practices are permissible, what practices are not. The other extreme view is, if the religion says this is essential, the practice must be permitted. According to me, the middle path is the best, because it still gives the power to the court and even to petitioners and to the citizens of this country to say that, okay, certain practices are acceptable, certain practices are not. The other two are extreme positions.
So one of the arguments of the respondents has been that the deity as legal personality and the deity also has rights. So as an amicus, how do you see this argument?
Let Parameshwar take the question.
I was furious at that argument. And I kept telling sir, no, somehow I am hoping that that argument doesn't even get recognized. I'll tell you why. In Hindu law, the deity is given, there is a legal fiction created that deity is capable of holding property. And that legal fiction is only to that extent. The legal fiction is a deity is a perpetual minor. And why was it necessary to confer this personhood on a deity? Because under Shastric Hindu law, people used to make gifts to the deity, to a temple. Now, there are certain cases where a deity is there without a temple, therefore gifts would also be, endowments would be made in the name of the deity. Huge lands would be endowed to the deity, and this is the origin of this doctrine. Huge lands would be endowed to the deity. There would be trespasses on that tomorrow. So in 12 years' time, they would claim adverse possession against the deity. So you needed to invent a method by which you would protect the interest not just of the deity, but people who have belief in the deity and who have endowed property on the deity. That's how the legal fiction came to be created, saying the deity is a perpetual minor. And it's going to be very interesting, because this is the argument in the Ayodhya case, that even if the church was demolished, even if, mosque was demolished, even if possession was in the hands of the Waqf board for 200 years or more, the land belongs to the deity. Deity is a perpetual minor, so limitation doesn't run against the deity. That is the original. What is the pitfall of saying the deity? And it was argued very strenuously that the deity is a person enjoying rights under Part 3. They went to the extent of saying the deity has a right to privacy. It's all very good. In the sense, it sounds a brilliant argument. But our answer was very simple to that. The deity is a person. The deity is also subject to the same constitutional morality like you and I are. Just see the consequences of this argument. You are going to say that the deity is going to be subject to the same restrictions in Part 3. Are we willing, is a believer willing to say that his deity must be subject to the same constitutional limitations? Because then, if he's a person, you have a duty under Part 4A of the Constitution, to fundamental duty to foster rationality and scientific temper. So, just imagine the pitfalls. If you say that, just imagine the pitfalls. It seems a very, very attractive argument from the side of the respondents. But the moment you say this, then you have to, all the constitutional obligations tag on, no?
And also, a deity may be capable of holding property, just like a non-natural person, like a company or a corporation, can own property. But what is the right we are talking about here? Article 25, what is the right which is being claimed? Freedom of conscience and the right to profess, practice and propagate religion. So can a non-sentient person have a conscience? Can he or she profess, practice or propagate a religion? So what was the right which the deity was claiming as a person?
Yes. So, sir, before going to the question, I had a little correction which I wanted to suggest. So, it was on 33 crore some lords which we have in Hinduism. So, it's actually 33 kind, like types of lords and deities we are described in the Atharva Veda somewhere. I'm not able to recollect. And when it, and the question, I just wanted to ask the same question which was asked by one of my friend before me.
Correction taken.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, I'm from the third year. So my question is about the clashes between Article 25 and 26. So if you see that wordings of 25 start saying that it is subject to the other parts, but if you see the Venkataraman case,
that's right.
Yeah.
Yes, please.
Yeah. So if you see that case, in that the court interpreted it in the exact how the articles were worded in the Constitution. So what take on that? And second question is, here now the respondents claim that the deity is a celibate, so women should not be allowed to enter. But in their own affidavit, the High Court case, they have clearly accepted that during that time, for a period of, let's say, 5 days during 20, out in every month, they were allowed to enter. So how do you, how does, where does that celibacy go for those 5 days?
I must compliment, before answering your question, I must compliment all of you, and because from the kind of questions which have come so far, it is very clear that you have been following the arguments, studied the case from this distance, and all the questions which have come so far have been very, very informed questions. So as far as Venkata Ramana Devaru is concerned, we have heavily relied on that case in support of our submissions. Venkata Ramana Devaru tries to harmonize these two provisions. And our argument is that is the test to be applied. Secondly, the fact that women have entered in the past is also a factor which has been relied on both by the amicus on this side and the petitioners to say that it doesn't even satisfy the essential religious practice test. Because if this entry was permitted in the past, obviously it was not something so core. Even the belief in the roop or the avatar was not a core belief.
Yeah. Hi, sir. Thank you for the talk. So I have two questions. One, privacy is understood in that individual core that one ought to be let alone. Now, in that context, in this question, it is about the entry to a place of public worship. Therefore, do you think there's a reasonable expectation of privacy in that context? That's one. The second, this is directed to Parameshwar, sir. So before you began with your 3 points, you raised concerns about an inquiry into the characteristics or the attributes of a deity. But isn't that a natural consequence of the essential practices test? And the second prong of the question is, isn't the essential practices test a consequence of constitutional morality itself in practice?
Okay, let me answer that. The first question, sorry, privacy, expectation of privacy. I'll tell you, define a public space. Let me give you an example. And this is a live case. And this was a matter of employment with the LIC. And they wanted to get a background of the health background of the employees they were hiring. So the woman was asked. The employee was asked to disclose in the form of employment what kind of menstrual record she had, in the sense whether regular menstrual periods, menstrual hygiene, etc. she was asked to disclose. And the court said very clearly this is no business of a employer, whether what kind of menstrual health that the woman keeps. Why we say that this is a forced disclosure? For the two reasons mentioned by Raju sir, that either way you disclose to people, to the world at large, what your menstrual status is. In a public place, should a citizen who wants to go to a public place be forced to disclose something as intimate as a menstrual cycle? Is why I am saying that there must be expectation of privacy is the right to visit a public space, even if it is a temple, can't be hedged on you giving up something as personal as personal and information as your menstrual cycle. Because if it is hedged on that, what sort of an access is it? I'm saying you're virtually bartering your fundamental rights. So what you're saying is, you give up your right to privacy, you might have a chance of exercising your right to worship. You understand? It is in that context. Don't see it as a public-private divide. That's the trap we fall into in privacy. Expectation of privacy, all that is a... The discourse can be very skewed if you start understanding in terms of expectation of privacy. Question is assertion of a fundamental right. If the assertion of a fundamental right depends on the giving up of another, is that permissible? I think that's the way to approach. Two, on essential religious practices. Essential religious practices doctrine does not have its roots in constitution. The practice of essential religious practices doctrine evolved in the context of seeing what is religious and what is secular. It is a contortion of that doctrine that today the court seems to inquire in each and every case whether it has scriptural evidence, it does not have scriptural evidence. If it has scriptural evidence, to what extent there is scriptural evidence. So, the origin of the doctrine is to differentiate between what is secular and what is religious. If it is essentially religious, non-interference from court. If it is a matter that is clearly secular, no matter what religious texts have to say about it, it will be a permissible regulation. So that's why I'm saying the straightforward example I can give is the appointment of archakas in a temple. For a long time, it was thought it is very is essentially religious to find out who the priest who should be worshipping this deity is. But historically, the power of appointment of an archaka is always vested with the sovereign. I'm saying not just British era, pre-British era also. The power of appointment always vested with the sovereign, and the sovereign was not necessarily somebody who was learned in the religion. So that's how they came to the conclusion that if the power of appointment, not the prescriptions of qualification, that's where the Supreme Court went wrong according to me. Supreme Court said the state can prescribe qualifications and do appointment. That's a problem. You understand? If it is the question of appointment is fine. So that's how the doctrine has its origins. So it's not in constitutional morality. The doctrine has its origins in finding out what is secular, what is religious. It doesn't have anything to do with morality. There was a question.
Hi, my question is only tangentially related to what you were talking about today. My question is only tangentially related to what you were talking about here. It's not entirely Sabarimala issue-related question. So earlier you were talking about how the amicus has to take a stance. Like, he can't just advise the judiciary. We can use law clerks for that. So on the same point, recently we've been reading about bar associations taking positions against defending certain criminals, alleged criminals to be more precise. So on that point, I understand there's a precedent and you can't take such stances because it's your professional ethics to defend whoever has to be defended and protect their constitutional rights. But to me, it sounds like you're forcing someone to believe things they do not want to believe. Because when you represent as a lawyer, you sort of believe in the case that you argue, at least to me. So when you refuse people by saying you cannot defend them, it is for a reason and stems from your own personal choice. So when the court is going to refuse that a professional association can't take such a stance, how would you look at it?
There are two different things here. If I feel that I can't do my professional duty because the crime with which X is charged is so heinous and abhorrent, and I am satisfied that I can't make any argument in his favor, so I will not be able to represent this person. That's a personal choice, right? But if I am able to transcend that abhorrence and still feel that I can offer a good legal defense. Let's take the most difficult case which I have done, the Ajmal Kasab case. Of course, an act of terrorism against the country is the most abhorrent thing one can imagine. When the judge who asked me to be amicus curiae said, I would request you to take up this case because we need to show the world what which in the highest court and the appeal the most terrorist get a senior advocate to argue duty to the and I felt that in all the facts loaded as far as evidence is concerned, if there was an open and shut case in criminal law, it was the Ajmal Kasab case. But there were plausible legal arguments to be made with regard to nature of particular offenses. There were plausible legal arguments to be made on the question of sentence. I felt that I could do justice to my brief, and therefore I went to that appointment. By not to take up where unaccused are arraigned. Well, if the lawyer there says, no, I don't want to take up a case, it's just too bad. It's just too bad. Then the only remedy which that particular accused has is to petition the Supreme Court and say, transfer it to some other case where perhaps I might find a lawyer willing to do my case. But if there is a lawyer willing to do a case, a bar association has no business to interfere with the conscience of an individual lawyer. That's the point. I hope that was your question. No, but no, it is an individual accused who is entitled to an individual lawyer. The lawyer is not being represented by the legal profession at large. He has a confidential lawyer-client relationship with lawyer X. And if lawyer X, his professional conscience allows him or compels him to take up the case of X, then his association can't tell him no. Don't take it up, otherwise we'll chuck you out.
Assuming that the current arguments in favor of Sabarimala Women's Temple Entry is accepted by the court, how long do you think can restrictions as against non-Hindu people in temples can sustain? Say for example, to be able to being equally entitled to freedom of conscience and my right to freely profess and practice any religion, shouldn't it mean any religion, no religion, and multiple religion at the same time? In the sense that religion also is not categorically defined. So what should restrict me in being a Muslim and at the same time being a worshipper of Ayyappa? Another question, what do you think is the object of this particular case? Say, for example, to my mind, it seems to be, the object of the case seems to be the, to satisfy a liberal conscience that this is how a society ought to be. We have had previous examples of temple entry being permitted by the court, but despite that fact, the local women being refusing to enter that. So the society, I mean, so it's not that the court say this or that, but the society or the audience that this, the court or the judgment seems to be addressing it doesn't seem to be wanting it. Say, for example, that it's the true devotees of Ayyappa has no argument that I need to visit Ayyappa during my ages, between my age of 10 or 50. And third one, how do you think that this, what do we say, this language of constitutional morality that is the coinage of the court now, would that become the new basic structure which would give unparalleled powers to the court in the coming days?
All brilliant questions in a row.
Last one, yes, untrammeled powers, there's no doubt about it. And I am sitting with a perpetual basic structure critique here. He'll also say yes to. He's been one of the most consistent critiques of the basic structure doctrine. I think yes. That's what I begin by saying, that you will fall into this liberal trap that where there'll be an increased demand for uniformity. You understand? No, it's all, when you speak, they will all speak about being diverse, diversity, all that. But the moment these standards start getting applied in court, no? You're right. I think there will be a lot more uniformity. The question, and that's the point also I made. I said that there is not one iota, there's no one piece of evidence in the entire case which suggests that there are devotees who want to enter the Sabarimala temple. That's a problem there. But at the same time, I'll tell you, it is a clear question of law in that sense that the court can't be seen by running away from a matter like this. Particularly because the first round which happened in the High Court was a petition that said women must not be allowed to enter the temple, and that writ petition was decreed, allowed. You understand? So, if I were on this side and this question is put to me today again, I would answer by saying the fact that there was a petition in the Kerala High Court which demanded, which resulted in the first judgment which the respondents are now relying on and saying, no, that is res judicata, that it was established, there was a full trial there. I would argue that that meant that women were being allowed to enter because the petition was to debar women from entry. You understand? So, if the flip side of the argument, when I say there's no evidence presented in this case, is the fact that that case was a case for... what was your first question? So, I have liberal conscience, I think to an extent, yes. There's no doubt about it because... the court has been very frankly doing a lot of liberal posturing these days. So I think you're on the point that there is some sort of institutional liberal conscience that the court wants to satisfy. And this has been the tendency of the court also over the years. It's not as if now it seems to be, the buzzword seems to be constitutional morality. For some time it was arbitrary and unreasonableness. For some time it was public interest litigation. We will look into petrol, we will look into autos, we will look into buses, we will look into Yamuna. Before that, court wanted to satisfy the liberal conscience by saying you can't have an absolute right of property. You understand? So it's only different eras of the Supreme Court. Every generation, I'm sure, said that the court is satisfying a liberal conscience in relation to a different subject matter. What was the first question, sir? That's the first question. That's a very crucial question. And we tried to make our argument that equally entitled to, when we said that equally entitled to in Article 25 is prefaced by an act of devotion or the affirmation of devotion. I understand if you affirm that you are a devotee, it's very problematic to say you must be allowed entry into a temple. My personal feeling, that can't be a bar. Because Hinduism should permit it. The essence of Hinduism should permit it. But I don't know what it is going to be in respect of other religions. A very problematic question that way. So we said equally entitled, not to the spot. You understand?
if you affirm belief in that deity, you are equal to enter and worship. But whether all religions, all temples, all institutions, all denominations will permit it, I think it should be a case by case.
Though I was not present in the whole discussion, sir, as a continuance of this, I want to say that few centuries ago, there was a restriction on the entry of certain people of belonging to certain caste. But after the coming of this constitution, the constitution itself said that there shall be no discrimination on the basis of caste, ancestors, race, and sex or something like that. Making the people aware of this fact, slowly this discrimination on the entry in the temple on the basis of caste is being eliminated. Sir, my question is that seeing this historical development in law, though constitution say that Article 15, I think, clause 2 say that the no citizen shall on ground race, caste, sex, and so what's your view on this thing that earlier there was discrimination on the caste, people feel that there was no logic behind it. Recently, though people have logic behind restriction of women in entry in temple, maybe in eye of law it's not logical. So, what's your view on it?
As you said, you were not here in the earlier part. We covered this when Article 25 says all sections and classes of Hindus, not meant only to allow castes which were kept out earlier to come, the temple entry laws, including in this case the Kerala law, when it permits all classes and sections, yes, includes women of this particular age group of 10 to 50, because women are definitely a class of Hindus, they are a section of Hindus. So what you are suggesting, that progressively we should move from caste to everyone else, it's already there in the constitution in its language itself.
Question is to Mr. Sure, because recently it is also asked, and there would be a question that this posturing of the court is only to satisfy the liberal attitudes of the society. But at the same time, can't we see that there are some very basic fundamental rights which are at stake? And you also gave the example or analogy that it is, you know, that a business concern is more protected, and it is, you know, very difficult to run a temple. And that's why you are saying that, okay, we can't, it is not right to ask to change the norm of a belief or how a temple is to be run, because it is like asking that, okay, if we ask PSU to change one of its articles of association. But if there is an article of association of a PSU which is violative of Article 14, 21, and 25, then of course it has to be changed. Because that is the concern here, because here the very three basic rights are at stake. So do you think that analogy fits into this situation? Because I'm confused about that.
Both the questions. When I said there is a liberal posturing, posturing was not perhaps the right word. Yeah, you're right. In the sense, no, I'll tell you, I'm convinced that the court is meant to be a counter-majoritarian institution. The judiciary is meant to be a counter-majoritarian institution. So it might look like posturing. It might look like posturing, but I think that's the role that the court is expected to play. You understand? That's why I said when every era would have had
one topic on which people thought that the court was posturing itself as the vanguard of one right or the other. Every era, this perhaps is the question of this era. The other question, and I anticipated this question, people would tell me, ask me whether if the Articles of Association is violative of one of the fundamental rights, what's wrong? My example was more to do with not the discriminatory clause, but the fact that the shareholder doesn't enter the company. I can understand the shareholder subscribes to the share of the petitioner subscribes to the company first and then seeks reform. I'll tell you why. Because then it says, in that case, she's affirming to the Articles of Association first. In this case, what you're saying is, no, I affirm to certain Articles of Association first, but before I become a full-grown shareholder of the PSU, you must strike down that clause, and then I come in as a shareholder. But in that example, the age does not have anything to do with the objectives of the corporation. You understand? The age does not have anything to do with the objectives of the corporation. If the corporation is meant as a corporation for, if the company is a company which permits only senior citizens to invest in it and says, no, this is for the benefit, post-retiral benefits of government employees, so shareholders have to be only post-retiral government employees so that their financial security is ensured. Can an 18-year-old go and say, no, this company is doing exceedingly well, profits are enormous, dividends being paid out to oldies are much better than the dividends I get when I subscribe to the share capital. You understand the point. What is the object? If the condition is such that it pertains to the very essence of that corporation. You understand what I'm saying? Not on belief. I'm saying this is a perfectly rational example. Nothing to do with belief. The object of the corporation is to ensure that there is financial security to retired government servants. It permits only retired government servants to be shareholders in the company, not even another senior citizen. And it says this company will invest so that the security of...
very elaborately answering our questions. I mean, if any of you want to personally interact, they'll be at the CC for a while till I think 3 o'clock maybe. Thanks for coming. Thank you.